Good morning, everybody. This is my name is Dr. Sangeeta Kale. I'm working as the moderator for this particular event today, and I am also a PIC member and working in Defense Institute of Advanced Technology. So let me all invite everybody here for this PIC Adda program today. A little bit talk upon what is PIC and also introduce you to the speaker of today, that is Advocate Vaishali Bhagwat. About Pune International Center, most of the PIC members of course are completely aware of PIC, but since this is an open talk, a public talk, I'll just quickly tell about Pune International Center. So Pune International Center is basically a think tank. It comprises of eminent personalities from Pune, who are in the domain of science, technology, commerce, architecture, law, finance, arts, and so on, also in all walks of life. There are more than 300 PIC members as of now in PIC. We basically conduct different lectures, we conduct seminars, also workshops. Also, we are in writing policies for the Government of India. There are different verticals of Pune International Center, such as programs on social innovation, entrepreneurship, the research which is related to carbon neutrality, green energy, some arts forum are also conducted under PIC platform. Out of multiple verticals, Pune International Center has got this PIC Adda under which we are meeting today. PIC Adda is a vertical where we conduct lectures of eminent personalities and is normally intended for only PIC members. However, since now we are in a web mode, we are conducting it as a public lecture, and today we are very fortunate to have Advocate Vaishali Bhagwat as the speaker for today. All of you must have seen her profile, but quickly I will just introduce Advocate Vaishali to you. So she is a practicing lawyer with 22 years of experience in the domain of litigation and advisory practice in Pune as well as in Mumbai. She specializes in cyber law, privacy law, and she also handles general, commercial, and civil cases. She has represented different clients in the course of several high-profile cases, which are in the domain of cyber fraud, data theft, hacking, cyber defamation, insider corporate fraud, online harassment against women and children, and so on and so forth. She's been an invited person in Pune Police for some of the cyber crimes which are related to cases which were conducted by NASCOM and also CIA. She's a member and expert panel formed by CIA Delhi for digital transformation, and also she's a member of an expert committee of Maharashtra Commission for Women on Online Harassment, and member as an expert panel cyber. Vaishali has studied at Bradford University in UK for her post graduation. She's also a TCS Evening Scholar on Cyber Policy and Cyber Defense. She has won several recognitions and awards. There are many to her credit, out of which one of the mentionable ones at a very higher level is by NASCOM and Data Security Council of India, which she was given in 2017 for keeping children safe online. She is an invited speaker at Rotary Annual Convention School, which was on the similar topic, in Vietnam, as a chief guest for annual security consultants conference to speak on cyber resilience. She's a recognized Rotary International District member, and she has put her outstanding contribution as a professional, and Rotary has conferred her with Vocational Excellence Award and Change Maker Award for Women Empowerment. She has been given this award called as Rana Ragini Award and Women of Substance Award in recent times. So Vaishali, very welcome to you on this particular platform. And before we start with our question and answers in formal session, I would request you to say a few words before we start with our session. Advocate Vaishali.
Thank you very much for this very kind introduction and the invitation that you and Dr. Amitabh Mallick have extended to me so that I could interact with very august audience of PIC. I've heard a lot about PIC. I've also attended one or two of your ADDA sessions at TMTC, and it's an absolute pleasure to be addressing all of the members and of course people who've joined from Hunan members on a topic which is not only very dear to my heart, but which is very relevant in recent times and getting more and more relevant. And, you know, when you extended this invite, I also had a very selfish motive to accept because I know that the audience will have people who will influence policy. And I know that working at grassroots level, how difficult it can be at times to implement legislation. And justice delivery sometimes is merely on a piece of paper. And I'm going to spell out some of the difficulties that we do face when it comes to cybercrime, so legislation or gathering digital evidence and all these things, especially when we know that the Prime Minister is now about to roll out a new cybersecurity policy. And we're just hoping that things get better than what it was when it started in 2013. So as I said, I do have a selfish motive also to be here. So thank you very much.
Thanks, Vaishali. So let's start with few question and answers. So let us start at a very basic level, because here as a normal citizen, we always hear these some jargons such as cyber stalking, you know, online theft, privacy invasion, then phishing, cyber phishing. So can you just tell us as to what is exact meaning of cyber crime and what are the different types of cyber crime?
Sure. So Sangeeta, you know, as we had also discussed, what I'm going to try and do is I am not going to actually throw a lot of legal jargon at everybody and sections and this law and that law, which eventually I will, if time permits, so that we know exactly where the law stands and where we need to be in terms of relevant legislation. But I'll try to speak in sort of layman terms when it comes to explaining what cybercrime is. So in fact, I had prepared a list of all the cybercrime cases, sort of which I must have handled throughout my career. And it actually spans an entire spectrum of how cybercrime landscape has developed over the past few years in India. So if you see, it can be as simple as social media crimes. Financial crimes actually top the list. I'm going to use the words like hacking, phishing a little later, because those are terms which are more colloquial rather than legal. But if I have to broadly classify crimes, then it would be financial frauds, social media crimes, say corporate frauds or insider frauds when it comes to corporates. There could be intellectual property infringement in cyberspace. Cyber warfare is something that we all need to understand what it really means, and as citizens, do we have a role to play so that we do not act as a conduit to a cyber warfare attack that may happen on your country. So that is also something that is relevant in today's time. When it comes to, so what I thought is and I know my first answer itself may be a little lengthy. What I'll do is I'll just give one or two examples under each of this category. So again, it puts the subject more in perspective. So if I have to say financial frauds, it actually means a lot of acts which happen on the internet or in cyberspace, where the ultimate aim is to cheat a person for money. Now, there are various ways and means that this is done. What I've seen, particularly when it comes to business-related financial frauds, I can name two very classic examples, and we generally call it as business email scams. In one of the very recent cases that I handled, it's a very interesting case because, and again, it does happen to people like you and me, people who are out there educated, doing running large businesses, but it can happen that you just fall prey to email which just sounds very genuine. So this person that I knew received an email on his business account, which seemed to be a business inquiry for supplying herbal products. An inquiry had come from Sweden saying that we know that these natural substances are available in India, and we have this business proposition for you. What you will do as a result of this business proposition is you'll be supplying us those natural products that are available in India, and of course the profit margins are say 100% or 200%, large profit margins. So they engaged in this conversation. It was decided that he will procure one of the samples and deliver it, and it was always immediate payment against delivery. So as a trial, one delivery happened and he also got the payment. With this assurance that, you know, this is working, more orders were placed, multiple orders were placed, and I'm not going to take much time, but let me tell you the number of orders that the money that this person invested in order to supply the product was nearly up to 1.5 to 2 crores. Expecting that the money will come, and there's been huge email correspondence every time, and assurances being given to him that yes, with the next tranche this payment will come through, with the next consignment the payment will come through, etc. And eventually it didn't come. In fact, in order to recover this money, he got himself involved in another similar scam, and total loss was up to 3 crores. Why this case really stands out for me is the persons who came to me was his wife and his daughter, and they both told me that they had lost. So the daughter had lost her father, say, a month back, who was this gentleman who had engaged in this conversation. And she said, when we looked into the business, we realized that about 4.5 crore debt was written in the papers. They had no clue what all these packets were lying in the factory premises, or these products which were procured of these natural substances. And this gentleman had actually lost his life because of the monetary liability that he had incurred. So, I mean, it is something that was not only sad, but it actually shows how gullible people can be when it comes to transacting on the net. And again, people like you and me who are educated and in business. Another very, very common fraud is another type of a business email fraud is when there is an ongoing transaction and you get an email in between saying that rather than making the payment to the original bank account that you were supposed to make, please make the payment in some other bank account. People do go through some due diligence. They try to check whether, you know, they have a branch office in that country and any presence in that country. But this also is a very typical way of siphoning off money. Let me also tell you from experience, it's very, very difficult to recover the money if the money has been deposited in accounts outside India. Pune police will have at least 50 pending cases of businesses in and around Pune who have lost crores of rupees in these business email frauds. And why do these happen? Because the systems of these businesses are not secure. They have been infected with malware. Their emails have been compromised, and there is a what we call it as a man in the middle attack. People who can actually read their emails and strike at the right time to divert the money in other accounts. So later on, of course, I'll come to as to what can be done so that you people don't succumb to these kind of frauds. But as I said, very, very common, and we get multiple queries and multiple cases which get reported. I mean, this is just like the tip of the iceberg. I've just talked about two types of, you know, business frauds. But for say, laymen, and now with digital payments being encouraged across cities and semi-urban areas, Paytm, Google Pay, Bheem apps, all those frauds, OLX, all these frauds are absolutely on the rise. Simply because people are not using the applications in the right manner. I will not find fault inherently with the app itself and its security, but the way people tend to use it very casually without really paying attention to what could be secure, safe practices, people tend to lose out again on a lot of money. And if there is a question as to what we need to do, maybe I can answer it at that time, what you need to do to be safe with, say, payment applications. Then, of course, there's another gamut of SIM cloning, where people lose money because your OTP is so you we all have two-factor authentication when it comes to accessing our bank accounts. So if an OTP is sent to a cloned SIM card, you tend to lose money from your banking accounts, your credit cards, from your debit card can be cloned. Again, these are, again, very, very common crimes. So I'm going to stop here so you can get on to your next question.
Yeah, it is actually quite, what you said, dreadful to know that people fall into these kind of prey pretty easily. And as you rightly say, it must be basically because of the authenticity with which these people write emails to each other and convince somebody to fall into the crime. Vaishali, the next question is related to the recent scenario in our country. Since the COVID times and also in the past few years, there is a lot of emphasis given by the government on digital platforms. So people are actually trying to use multiple online systems such as Google Pay, Paytm, since you mentioned a bit about it also in the previous answer, Razor Pay, Amazon Pay, so many things are there, Bheem is there. So my question is this, that are all these platforms safe? Or do you recommend that one has to see the following things, you know, before you start using a particular app? And the most important part of the question is also this, that are we ready for it as a country? So even though government gives emphasis, are we really ready digitally? Are we safe to use these apps? How far India has come? Is India geared up for these kind of financial transactions online?
So very valid and a relevant question in today's times, because I see there is actually a divide between people who go all out and use these apps without really thinking whether it works properly or not, and then there are some who absolutely refuse to get onto the digital payment platforms because, you know, they're so cynical about whether this is going to work or not. So let's get the basics straight here. Apps per se are not insecure. So if you look at digital payment apps, they are a highly regulated industry. They are regulated by RBI, they are regulated by NPCI. They have to follow very stringent security norms to ensure that their backend security is absolutely robust. And as I said, they're very highly regulated in terms of the compliance. RBI is watching them. So app per se, I don't want to find any fault with them. Now the question is, are we using those apps properly? Something as basic as, have we even downloaded the right app? So for example, Bheem app. So if you see, and go to the Google Play Store, you will actually have apps and which are, you know, clones of these Bheem apps. So you will have Modi Ka Bheem, or you know, Bheem India, or Bheem UPI. So it is very important for all of us to first verify whether the app itself is valid or not. Because if you're going to download an app which itself is a fake app, then obviously your money is not going to reach the right destination. You are going to lose the money in the hands of the fraudster. So that's the first thing. There are various ways of finding out. You can read about these apps. You can go to the NPCI, RBI website to find out which are the regulated apps and which are the regulated payment platforms. Don't do it blindly. Don't do it just because somebody has told you that download this app. Do your own research and then try. The second thing is, once you download the app, another thing I would like to say is, security doesn't come by default. You need to do something to make your transaction secure. So first, it is very important to read all the security settings of your application and enable those security settings which make the application secure. Nowadays, there has been a lot of hue and cry that the default setting of any technology has to be a secure setting. All this while, since there were no standards which regulated this industry or even other technology, other default settings was always insecure, which meant it was porous. It meant that hackers could easily break into that technology. Nowadays, things are changing, there's more awareness, and there is a demand that security settings should be secure as default. Now, after you do that, after you understand what the security settings are and actually how to use the app, only then start using it. It doesn't happen automatically, especially in our age group. Maybe younger people intuitively start using apps much more in a better way than you and me do, or even understand how transactions work on the applications much better than what people in our age group do. So it's important that you understand the nomenclature, because we've seen, if it comes to Paytm, we've seen a lot of frauds which happen. So for example, I have to receive money from you. I don't need to do anything. I just need to give you my account number and you need to deposit. But there are certain options on these payment apps which say that you need to enable something for receipt of money. It appears to be that way, and that option gets exploited by these fraudsters and ask you to maybe send an OTP or click on a link. That is where people tend to lose money through the payment apps. Another safety measure that I generally ask people to do is identify what your risk posture is. For example, I want to take a risk of 50,000. Then what I do is I have a one debit card with a limit of say 25,000. I could have one account in which I put only 25,000 rupees, and only that account gets exposed to the internet. All my other banking accounts do not have internet exposure, which means in a worst case scenario, this is the amount that I'm going to lose at any given day. Try to limit that exposure, then automatically, so even when you're linking your digital payment accounts with your bank accounts, don't link it with accounts which will have substantial amount of money, because we are still in the development stage. We are not, we are not super users when it comes to technology. So these are, you know, practical ways of how to limit liability. There's another thing that we all can remember, that in case you lose money through these payment apps, there is an RBI digital ombudsman which says that if you report the loss within 24 hours, the payment company or the financial company or the bank has to refund the money to you in the next 7 working days, provided the bank or the financial institution does not have evidence that it was due to your negligence. So if it has happened due to the user's negligence, you are not entitled to receive the refund. So that is, again, there's a rider to the RBI ombudsman, digital ombudsman scheme that has been recently floated. But I urge everyone to immediately report, not only to RBI but also to the cybercrime cell, because this, and to the financial institution, because they are duty bound to refund the entire money within a certain amount of time. Of course, there will be an internal investigation. They generally will give you a shadow credit after investigation is complete, a full refund provided no negligent behavior of the user. So I think another question that you had was, are we sort of there? Are we mature enough to accept these? So maturity in terms of whether the apps are secure, my answer would be yes. User maturity is dismally low. We are very casual when it comes to use of technology. We think everything comes for free and it's secure. It doesn't happen that way. You know, it's too idealistic a world. You need to invest in security. And I would like to give out 3 words here, which you can remember as to what you need to do for security is people, process, technology. So security is never one pronged. It has to be 3 pronged. So you have to invest in technology to be secure. You have to be aware of how to use technology to be secure, and you should have the proper processes in place so that you use the technology securely. And if you do all these 3 things together, only then it is possible. We also say that when it comes to security, technology could be very robust. You may have the greatest of firewalls and, you know, the greatest of perimeter technology, so hackers can't get into your system. But if the hacker gets into your mind, and if you allow the hacker to get into your system, all that investment just is wasted.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. And it's important to remember this word. Probably PPT is a good way to remember it. People, process, technology. So yeah. The next question I have is, Vaishali has been in this particular profession for more than 20 years now. And as I see from the internet also, India ranks around third or fourth in the country, in the world, as far as cybercrime goes. Can you tell us as to some of the good cases or the best top cases that you might have solved in your career of more than 20 years? Let's say top three kind of cases.
So, Sangeeta, before going to my cases, let me just remind everyone that Pune actually was actually on the world map of cybercrime cases, because we reported the first mega cybercrime case way back in 2001-2002, oh, when one of the outsourcing centers in Pune was compromised, and some customers from a very large international bank lost tons of money. And that money was siphoned off from their accounts by a simple phishing attack. And the money was deposited in local banks in Pune. And it was a very big investigation that followed. Pune police also received a lot of credit for a very good investigation that was done at that time. So Pune in itself, contributed to... has contributed a lot in terms of the number of cybercrime cases that happen in Pune. So even today, I guess the maximum number of cases that get reported are in Pune, Mumbai and Bangalore. So we continue our in a way good, because it's important that reporting happens. The question would be, are we equipped enough to handle the case to its logical end after the reporting happens? And there could be a certain question marks when it comes to that. So let me just talk about a few cases which are not from, say, one bucket, but I'd like to talk about a corporate fraud case or an insider fraud, and then something to do with women and children. So again, we all get an idea of what all is happening in this cyberspace. So a few years back, we had a very interesting case which was reported by a very senior government official. Because there was a news item in the local newspaper which said that this government official had sanctioned big budgets for a renovation of his bungalow, and that definitely was not in line with what the policy was, and it didn't seem so right. And there was a lot of discussion and backlash on that senior government official because of the money that was being used to refurbish or almost build a new bungalow for himself. And in the news item, certain material was reproduced, which he told me, saying that, you know, this is exactly what I had written to my architect. This is a part of my email to my architect. So it has to be, and how did these figures come out? And how did he know about this? So somebody knows about my communication with the architect. And that is when we started the investigation. We came to know that, so we put his systems through some analysis, and we realized that his emails were being forwarded to an insider within the government organization. Not only this communication, which was between him and the architect, which was of course very confidential, but other confidential communications which he was doing with his ministry, and which was very, very crucial in terms of say government confidential information. Why this case was important? Because this is the first time in Maharashtra we invoked a section for hacking into secure computer systems, which is a non-bailable cognizable offense with up to 10 years of imprisonment. So this is the, because otherwise hacking per se is a bailable offense, but this became, it was not only interesting, but this was the first case that we registered under a particular section of the Information Technology Act. It's still going on and we are hoping for some good results in that case. Another very interesting case was which happened with the Pune police again a few years back. Those were the Orkut days, if any of you remember, that it was a platform for used for chatting and social media way before Facebook. So there was a profile on Orkut which said something very, very bad about Shivaji. I'm not going to say it here because I think we are also recording this. So, but it was definitely, it was extremely derogatory. Someone saw that profile and some reporter saw that profile and filed a case before the Pune police. The Pune police were also very enthusiastic in following up that whose Orkut account it was. And they traced the IP to a person living in Bangalore. He was immediately arrested and there was custodial interrogation. Every time during the custodial interrogation, he was helplessly crying and he kept saying, I don't even know who this Shivaji is. I remember talking to the investigating officer at that time when this interrogation was going on. And, you know, I quite appreciate how the police also have their own way of not really relying on technology, but how humans interact and the type of cases they've seen through their career. So this IO, very senior gentleman in the Pune police used to say, you know, madam, mujhe nahi lagta isne kiya hai. I have seen so many criminals. Lagta hai kuch technical investigation mein kuch problem aaya hai. So what we did was, so the IP was returned to us from a internet service provider or a telecom service provider. So we sent the query again. We sent the query again and the result was some other address and name. And the telecom service provider apologized saying that there was a mistake in their earlier report given. I mean, you're dealing with human life here. You have somebody in custody whom you've picked up wrongly. Immediately, the Pune police filed an application, so he was let off from custody. He came out boiling mad from his imprisonment, and he said, I'm going to slap a case for compensation on the police force at that time. And I think he did. I'm not very sure what happened to the civil case. But when this news was splashed on front page Times of India, the Human Rights Commission took a suo to cognizance of it and called up the police department for wrongful investigation and wrongful confinement. I represented the police. We made our representations before the Human Rights Commission. The good thing that happened from this was that they gave a direction that a full-fledged cyber crime investigation manual should be prepared for not only the police to follow, but even other stakeholders. For example, you see a lot of data which is in the custody of internet service providers or telecom service provider. So what are the good practices intermediaries or stakeholders should follow when it comes to cybercrime investigation? So this was another quite an interesting fallout of a case which happened about a social media account. Another very disturbing case which I recently handled was about a handicapped girl. She was, say, 13, 14 years old. She had met with a terrible accident. She was paralytic from her waist downwards. Because of that, she could not attend school and she was doing school from home. Because of this condition, no longer friends were visiting her. Friends, you know, she really didn't have a friend circle. And during this lonely time, she had befriended somebody on Facebook, very, very close to that person. And eventually her parents realized that, you know, she was getting very restless. She constantly wanted to go out. She said, I want to go to this coffee shop and ask the maid to, you know, assist her. She used to insist that the driver takes her there. So they questioned her. She was not giving out any information. So me and another colleague of mine who's a cybercrime investigator, We tried to look for evidence, and we went through a computer to see what all was happening. And we realized that she had this person that she's been talking to over a period of time has been exploiting her sexually. She has been uploading nude and semi-nude photos of herself. There has been chatting which was very sexually explicit. And obviously, she was under a complete control of that person who had represented that, you know, he is a very close and friend of hers, etc. When the arrests happened, we realized that it was a huge gang operating out of Delhi and Gurgaon, and the modus operandi was, we typically in this parlance, we call this as grooming. It is their business to look for such soft targets, ask them to upload videos which are, or images which are sexually explicit or has nudity or obscenity in it, and then of course make money out of it, or eventually blackmail that person for extortion of money. Very, very common. That is why, you know, this sort of awareness is also very important when it comes to our parents and our children, because children are soft targets. And in fact, India is looked at as a country for sexual tourism. So we, not only Indians are targeting our children, but it's also the foreigners who are actually looking out for our children for sexual exploitation. So that one of the very disturbing cases that, you know, and I wish I don't have I wish these such cases don't happen. Another, if from the corporate fraud scenario, insider frauds are really, I mean, it's the order of the day. And I had a very interesting case of a very large IT/ITS institution in Pune, where a very senior director of that organization was doing competing business, right, sitting in his chair as a director. And he had an entire team to his disposal, and he was using the entire team, the source code, resources of the company to develop a competing product, which was given outside to a company where his wife was a partner or a director. How did we come to know about it? Because there was another person who wanted to use those resources for development, and every time those people used to say, no, we are busy with another project, we are busy with another project. So he escalated it, saying that what is this project that I cannot lay my hands on these developers or these people who can work on another project. And then when questions were asked and the data was seen in the background covertly, we realized that an entire semi-business was being run from within the organization to develop a competing product. And it came as a big blow to the company. And as I said, it's very common insider frauds go unnoticed, and the worse, it goes unreported because businesses don't want to report it. The only thing they will eventually do is terminate that person, but the losses are huge. And because of this backlash that will come in the public domain, generally corporate frauds people don't want to report them. Yeah, I guess I've spoken enough. We want to go to the next question.
The next question is related to the current times in the country, throughout the world, I should say, the COVID times. And because of these COVID times, most of the education, most of the business has come to a standstill, but the most affected sector is the education sector, where the children are now studying online, the schools are doing online education, lectures are conducted, everything is done online, the parents are busy handling the children are busy handling the teachers are busy handling the entire system as such. So in this, since you have been given this NASSCOM award for keeping children safe online, I'm sure you can throw more light on what are the do's and don'ts in this particular sector of education, online education. So can you tell a little bit about it?
So I think I'll just quickly talk about this subject. Let me say that it's a multi-stakeholder responsibility. When it comes to children, it's the parents, it's the teachers, it's the head of schools, managing trustees or the trustees of the academic institution. police officers, counselors, all are part of one ecosystem who have to work together to keep children safe online. Children are vulnerable, children do not have discretion, and they also have this thrill of doing, you know, something on the net which they feel others will not come to know, or even they may not be affected. But cyberbullying, sextortion, revenge porn, trolling, all these are so common, and the unfortunate part is children don't talk to their parents, and most of the crimes will go unreported. In fact, the scar that our children may have due to, you know, because they get exposed to violent content or extremely harsh, obscene content. So let me just give you a quick example. Most of the parents that I speak to, they say, no, you know, they actually just play games. And if you see, most of the games have a chat function where you are expected, the gamers are expected to chat with each other about the game. Let me tell you, at least 30% of the people who are on these chat functions are pedophiles, who are there to have a conversation with our children so that eventually sexual exploitation will happen. Different things are done. You know, we call this, let's say, desensitizing. So they will start talking about sexually explicit of subjects or information in a very mild manner, just to see how the child is responding. The child gets used to that sort of conversation, and then they escalate till the child is completely desensitized to that extent that the child doesn't even know this is something wrong and needs to be reported. Sometimes threats are used. Sometimes, you know, they get lured. So they say, okay, I'm going to give you 10 points, which are those gaming points. So it's almost like a bribe. Then the child thinks, oh, because I've taken this favor from him, I need to do this. So there's a different ways on which the people play on the child psychology. So if I have to give a simple answer, having an open conversation with children is extremely important, and not wear blinders that our child is not indulging in sexual conversation or sexting or watching adult content. They are. So it's better that we talk about it. The second is use tools and technology so that you have the right filters in place so that your child is not exposed to unwanted content. I think I'll just give you one more case that I recently again handled was a boy who had subscribed to a dating site on internet. And the dating site said, if you pay a subscription fee so-and-so, and this girl will spend a day with you. He was very excited about it, and he paid what subscription fee of 2,500. And then it was decided that on this Wednesday, they will meet at you know, some place, and they will just spend the day together. And it's a date, and then she will go back by, say, 6 p.m. I was all very excited, but as the day came closer, he panicked. So a day before, he wrote an email to that dating site saying that, I'm sorry, but I want to cancel my subscription and date for tomorrow. So the site says, okay, if you want to cancel and if you want this refund of 2,500, there is a process. You will have to pay another 10,000 rupees, and then we will return this 12,500 to you in the next 7 working days. But you will have to do that. A plain refund is not possible. So he deposits the 10,000. Then he gets another email saying that we need you to deposit another 25,000 for XYZ reason. Since he had completely panicked, he talks to a friend saying that, can you loan me that money? This friend reports it to his father saying that, you know, so-and-so was asking for 25,000. I think he's in trouble. So the two fathers spoke to each other when the boy's father realized that there's something wrong. And that's when they all came to me. And the funny part was, this boy, when he was writing to that website, the website people were telling him, if you don't pay this amount, we will report it to the cybercrime cell that you had paid money for a date. Threatening him that he had done something which was so morally wrong that it was almost a crime. And you know, I and the parents were also, they were completely shattered that how could he do this? We have such middle class values. And I kept telling them that if you're going to behave in a manner that these things don't exist in the world and your children are not exposed to it, you'll never be able to help your children. You have to accept that they are going to do things like this. And you should have an environment where he could have come to you and told you that I was on a dating site, rather than hiding it from you as if he had done something which was, you know, so wrong morally and ethically. So yeah, so when it comes to keeping children safe online, we have robust laws. We have the POXO legislation, which came in 2014, very, very robust legislation, where it puts a duty on all of us to report any case which involves a child, which there is mandatory reporting to the local police or the juvenile unit. Else, you and me are in trouble if we don't report. I won't go. I know we may be running out of time, so I think this is enough when it comes to. But there are laws, there is stakeholder responsibility. Schools need to take responsibility and have internal redressal mechanisms to ensure that such things don't happen. And if they do happen, then the redressal is timely and done most of the times internally. You need not go to the police all the time.
Sure, yeah, thank you. We will have one last quick question before the questions start coming from the audience. The corporate world, the way in which we have an education system and education world and the children in the picture, in the same way we have a big corporate world around. Where there are multiple ways in which people are working in hierarchy and things like that. So do you recommend any kind of safety awareness or do you suggest or advise anything, any specific way in which people should respond for the corporate kind of communication?
So when you say corporate, say how are corporate exposed to cyber crimes? So there are common cyber crimes, for example, ransomware attacks, or insider frauds, or data breaches, loss of money, loss of intellectual property, which are across the board. But there could also be sector-specific fraud. So healthcare may be succumbing to specific cyber threats and cyber frauds. You have banking, which are a huge target when it comes to financial frauds. You will have matrimonial sites, which are another, you know, in an booming industry, most unattended, or say where attention is not, and maximum number of frauds happen on matrimonial sites, and women lose money in lakhs and crores of rupees when it comes to matrimonial fraud. So each industry has its own challenges. So I think earlier I used those three words: people, process, technology. That is the mantra for any industry to ensure cyber security and safety. First, have technology in place. Invest in technology. Do not wait for an incident to happen. Everywhere I see, there are always budget constraints when it comes to security budgets. How much to spend on security? Well, that's a call that you need to take depending on your risk posture. But you will have to invest in some sort of a technology product for security. So that's the technology part taken care of. But it's finally the people who use technology. So are people aware? Are people aware of simple things like password protection, using certain technology wisely and safely, not clicking on links and attachments, not succumbing to phishing attacks? So are people aware as to, and the classic example is Stuxnet, the Iranian power plant, which must have been so highly protected with technology on cybersecurity, but a malware like Stuxnet could actually enter the Iranian power plant because it was one person who thought, oh, let me insert this pen drive and see what is there in the pen drive, where he eventually infected the entire ecosystem of the nuclear power plant. It's a very it's a documented case that there was almost a nuclear holocaust because of that malware. So it can be as stupid as that, and the consequences can be catastrophic. And processes. Do you really have a process to handle an incident? The breach is bound to happen. Hacking is bound to happen. But do you have a process in place to bounce back to your normal working. So I mean, we now nowadays new terminology is used as resilience. So it's not just cyber security and cyber safety, it's also cyber resilience is your ability to bounce back to with full work potential, even if you're compromised by a cyber attack.
Okay. So thanks a lot, Vaishali, for elaborating on the corporate side as well. So we come to the end of the questionnaire that I had planned in my mind. So before we conclude the talk, we will take few questions. So there are some questions which are coming. Professor Malik, you have something to ask before I go to the questions?
Yes, I could ask later or now, but anyway, now that I'm here, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, my question is, the cyber crimes are going to go on increasing. Just awareness at the level of the public is not going to be adequate. So is there a plan to, for instance, the cyber currency that will itself generate all kinds of opportunities for more fraud and all more things? So as a systemic approach, are we looking at in the next few years how we can reduce the level of crime? I'm actually talking about detecting the crime or a crime intention through AI, so that the overall systemic control will be there in terms of an ecosystem where the crime will be much lower. Is that a possibility?
Yes, sir. It's definitely a possibility, and a lot of efforts are going into developing such cybersecurity products. It is the how the corporates budget and invest in cybersecurity products based on their risk posture, and it also depends on what is the sensitive information that they need to safeguard and then invest in ensuring that their systems are safe. But that happens at the corporate level. When it comes to individual level, such products are still not available in the market for public consumption. Open source material is not available. Technology products are very expensive, out of reach of. So this is where a lot of work needs to be done so that affordability of the products is targeted. Yes, sir.
My question was slightly different. I'm saying as a system, as a government, or as a larger committee of nations, is it possible that we use AI, artificial intelligence, for creating an ecosystem that will not allow so much of misuse of the cyber medium?
I think at a conceptual level, so definitely. I wish I had a better answer than this as what really are the methods that are getting deployed by, say, India, if not anybody else, to come up with such technology that is so all pervasive so that all our systems get covered in it. But I'm not really aware of any such initiatives undertaken right now by the government.
Thank you.
Okay. Vaishali, many questions are coming up, so I will quickly ask you. Mr. Pankaj, he's asking that as the cyber world is growing so fast and so huge, do you think that cybercrime education in higher education policy should come up as a compulsory paper? Do you think that it can be done? Do you think that it should be a part of our enhanced syllabus or something?
Okay. So my take on it is higher education it needs to be introduced at the lowest level, kindergarten level, because if you're going to say my child can actually fiddle with a smartphone when he's 3 or 4 years old, it means that security and safety needs to be talked about from that level itself. Unfortunately, we all are conditioned to, you know, learn a subject if it is marked. And if that is our ecosystem, then yes, having a compulsory paper, there's no choice. And we've been talking about it for so many years, and I really have no clue why it has not been introduced in our education system, and why NGOs and outsiders need to go and talk to schools about cybersecurity. Why is it not something that is inbuilt? If you're offering ICT classes, then security and safety is part and parcel of it. It can't be separated out. So it not only higher education, yes, I have also seen a lot of syllabuses on cybersecurity when it comes to higher education. And I have to say this here that it is very lopsided. It leans a lot towards the technical aspects rather than a user perspective as to safe use of technology. It's more about how operating systems are, and it's more technical rather than user friendly. So the answer to this is yes, higher education definitely needs it. Sometimes I feel it's too late. People, children right from the age of 12, 13 they know their way around systems. They know how to hack, they know how to misuse, they know how to cover their tracks. So it has to be at a much lower grade.
Yeah, I agree, because many times we do hear parents saying that the kid is continuously working on the phone and we don't know what he is doing. And they take pride in that. Instead of that, I think they can educate the kid as well.
Yeah, so, and you know, the unfortunate part, when the kids say the same about parents, oh, my mother is on the phone all the time. So, you know, you don't know who to educate first.
Yeah. Okay. More question is from Mr. Siddharth Bhagwat. He says that do paid VPN subscriptions really help secure my internet connectivity, internet access?
So I think a basic answer is it's better than a free version because it's a paid version. So there's an assumption that they will give you better facility and better tools. But just because it is paid does not give you the satisfaction that it is secure. It is important that you assess the security level that is offered to you by the paid VPN. You should also ensure that the settings of the VPN are set properly so as it caters to your requirement and your business and what you're getting for that cost. So that has to be assessed, first technically assessed. I'm not a technical person, but this much I know, that you need to have an intervention of a technologist or a cyber safe security specialist to assess the security posture of a technology that you will be deploying for remote access.
Okay.
And again, at the cost of repetition, there is no security by default. There is a security that needs to be configured.
I think we'll go to this last question. Mr. Vivek is asking, is cryptocurrency legal in India? I know that this crypto thing is a different topic altogether, and it's a big topic, but can you quickly say something about
it? So it is not illegal. So we are midway, you know, it is neither legal. There is no legal parlance in terms of where I say it is, you can trade in the currency, but it has not been illegalized. So if you look into any criminal law book, you will not find any section that says dealing with bitcoins is an illegal but it is not recognized by law. So, you know, so we are in that cusp. It's not recognized by law, not validated by RBI, not regulated by RBI, but not declared unlawful.
Okay. So I think we will stop the question and answers.
I have something written on my LinkedIn on Bitcoin, if he wants to go and read it, about, you know, this legality conundrum of Bitcoins.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. So as we come to the end of this particular interactive session, let me thank Vaishali for a wonderful session. The take-home things which I learned from the talk today is that security doesn't come by default. This is point number one, I think, which was a very important point. Then limit your accounts in such a way that connect only a small part of your funds towards the internet banking if you are doing so, and people, process and technology. I think these are the important things which I can remember for myself at least. So thank you, Vaishali, and let me give the control to Dr. Amitabh Malik and also Vijay Kelkar sir. If anything has to be specifically, any comment, any suggestion, anything that you would want to say and conclude.
No, Sangeeta, I really enjoyed the presentation of Ms. Bhagwat. I wish we had recorded it because I think it would have been very useful those who didn't attend it. Because I think what warning she has given for...
I think it is recorded. I think it is getting recorded. It is.
I learned a lot of things, but I think it's more useful young parents to watch it. A very interesting and important thing she has sourced. So maybe we can upload on, I'm sure with her permission, on our website, we can consider.
Yeah.
Because it's a very, very valuable. Thanks a lot. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Advocate Vaishali. That was very wonderful. And I think you will be happy to know that at the peak, we had 107 participants. Very, very large interested crowd, and well interested. So this subject itself was very interesting, very close to heart. Many people want to know how to be safe and secure. And you've done a wonderful job, and Sangeeta has made a nice summary of the few points. So to begin with, I must, on behalf of PLC,
Malika, I have one request to Ms. Bhagwata that she should look at our website, download the for membership,
yes.
Become member of PIC, because we want people like her.
Yes.
It's their generation to take over PIC.
You'll be happy to know that she has already agreed.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Great.
I was already on the job, and finally successful in convincing her that she should be a part of the family.
Yes,
PIC family.
Absolute pleasure to be part of the group. Thank you.
Yeah.
It is all Pune. Our Pune, we are trying to do it.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Okay. So thank you, Vaishali. Thanks a lot. And hope to have this video also online. So we'll share the links also with everybody.
Yeah.
Thank you, Dr. Malik, the caterer, and Dr. Sangeeta. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Well done.
Bye-bye.
All the best.
Thanks.